You know, everyone has a special pet project or a special place in their heart for a particular cause. Maybe it's the economy, corruption in politics, abortion, immigration, or even starving families in third world countries. The truth is that there's no shortage of causes to occupy our minds or time. I know that. So with everything that you've got going on in your lives, you might ask yourself, why should I care about Israel? Well, the focus and interests of everyone around the world is diverse. I recognize that when you leave and get back into your hustle and bustle of day-to-day life, anything I've got to say about Israel, well, it's likely to simply fade into the background. Unless, of course, I could show you that the past, present, and future of everything you are is intrinsically linked to Israel. But that's impossible, right? Well, my mission today, should I choose to accept it, is in the next 14 minutes to show you how the very principles and practice of your Christian faith, your personal spiritual walk as you live it each day, and virtually every aspect of your physical day-to-day life, even living halfway across the world from Israel, along with the most important and relevant world events occurring across the globe today, all have at their very core an important element or aspect of the nation of Israel. Let's face it, that'd be a pretty good trick. It does sound kind of impossible to prove that a nation that occupies about 1/100th of 1% of the Earth's landmass can affect your faith, your day-to-day life, and the entire world that you live in. I mean, how can a tiny nation that has only about 1/10th of 1% of the world's population and exists nearly half a world away impact you and everything about you? It'd be like, I don't know, dropping a small button in the middle of an empty room. Well, you know, there are lots of countries much larger than Israel whose names you've probably never even heard of. Countries like Gabon, Togo, Burkina Faso, Mali, Mauritania, and who could forget Fredonia? I mean, how many people remember Fredonia? It's one of the first Marxist countries, and I believe it may be the only Marxist government on record that didn't lead to devastation, ruin, and ultimately war, as you can see from this brief documentary.
These are the laws of my administration.
Gentlemen, as your Secretary of War, I...
The Secretary of War is out of order.
Department of Labor wishes to report that the workers of Fredonia are demanding shorter hours.
Start by cutting their lunch hour to 20 minutes.
I washed my hands of the whole business.
We're all set now, aren't we?
Hey, if you need a good reason to care about Israel, how about those nice Jewish boys, the Marx Brothers? And I'll throw in the Three Stooges for good measure. You know they're Jewish too, don't you? There, I can tell most of the men are with me already. For the rest of you diehards and skeptics, we'll throw in a few extra details and facts at no extra charge. And that's a bargain. Which, if you think about it, may be another good reason to care about Israel. Ladies, am I right? No? All right, let's move on. Can everybody see this? Well, this apparent jumble of letters has only the first and last letters in their proper place. And everything else appears to be all mixed up. Certainly people can read this almost instantly, but not everybody, while others really struggle. It's a lot like life and faith. In order to get the right perspective, it helps if you get the beginning and the ending down. Then the meaning of it all starts to fall into place. Beginning and ending. Let's see, for the beginning, in the case of the Bible, that would be the Garden of Eden, right? Did you know that a growing number of scientists now believe that the location of the Garden of Eden was actually in or around Jerusalem? In Genesis 2, 1 through 14, we find the names of four rivers, the Pison, Gihon, Hiddekel, and Euphrates. Now, only two of those rivers exist today. One is the Euphrates, and one of the others has been renamed as the Tigris. Because these rivers originate around Turkey or Iraq today, it led many to assume that somewhere around there must have been the location of Eden. And maybe the other two rivers just sort of dried up. Well, the Bible actually gives us a pretty good description of the rivers and even the direction of their flow. Neither of these two rivers match the flows, not described in the Bible. So let's say these scientists are right, and Eden actually was somewhere in or around Jerusalem. So where'd the water for the four rivers come from? In Genesis 2:10, it says, the source of the rivers came up from beneath the ground. Eden was even said to have a mist of water falling over the land, watering the fertile grounds, and the four rivers flowed out from there. In Ezekiel 47, 1 through 12, the Bible talks about vast amounts of water flowing from below the temple in Jerusalem. Scientists confirm that there are incredible reserves of fossil water stored below Israel still today. There's even a spring on the Temple Mount called the Spring of Gihon. By the way, Gihon means gusher. An underground aquifer under pressure might well account for the mist of water spraying over Eden and making it so fertile. So, where's that underground source today? What's changed? You know, there are two things that might account for these river changes. Number one, of course, the flood. As you recall, that occurred long after Adam and Eve in Eden. So the entire region was totally underwater, perhaps changing the course and existence of any prior riverbeds. Number two, the splitting or earthquake. You'll find that in Genesis 11:10, it took place 101 years after the flood. The Bible reports events coincided with the birth of Peleg, whose Hebrew name means a dividing by a small channel of water. And it's also the root associated with the term for earthquake. Based on the substantial tectonic rift located directly along the Red Sea, it comes as no surprise that a region-altering event like this may have been the cause of a major subterranean shift in the underground sources. So, how about the ending? Well, about 30% of the Old Testament's 28,000 verses, along with 21% of the nearly 8,000 verses in the New Testament, contain predictive material. You know, prophecy, end times, apocalypse, Jesus' return. And guess what? It all happens, yep, you guessed it, in Israel. Well, we're getting into more details about the end times and prophecy a little later. You're going to want to stick around. So why should we care about Israel? Because from start to finish, Israel is at the very foundation of the Abrahamic Judeo-Christian faith. Relationship. Well, let's see. The best place to learn about God's relationship, if you plan on having a relationship with Him, is probably from His Word. You learn about who He is, His rules, the manner of His rapport, like prayer, and how to speak to Him, how He regards us, and if we happen to screw up a little, we learn about His restraint, His reproof, His redemption, and His reward. Everything we need to know to have a one-on-one relationship. Now, we know these things because He demonstrated that relationship to His people, Israel. He made a covenant with His people, Israel. And if you're a Christian, as Christians, we've been grafted into that covenant through Jesus Christ. And if you're a Christian, we should care about Israel because, folks, we are Israel. And how about Scripture? In the Bible, the whole book is pretty much about His people, Israel. And it's about a patriarch named Israel. It's also about a place named Israel. So who are the other important patriarchs in the Bible? Well, let's see, there's Noah, there's Moses, and David. And did you know that Israel is mentioned more times than all of them combined? How about Jesus? Actually, He's only mentioned 1,275 times in the Bible. Israel, more than twice that. So besides Israel, where are the important places in the Bible? Let's see, there's Jerusalem, there's Bethlehem, Nazareth, Egypt. You know, all of them added together can't compare and compete with Israel. That's right, even the heavens, which are mentioned many, many times. Israel more than 500% more often. Even the use of the nonspecific pronoun there, referring to any other place on the face of the earth, doesn't appear as often as the term Israel does. What about the important themes of the Bible? How about faith, hope, love, charity, and prayer? Every form of the word pray. That's pretty important stuff. Doesn't it seem like the words of the Bible, that the majority of them are about these specific themes? And yet, if you added up all these words, all the times they appear in the Bible, they still wouldn't equal the number of times God speaks of Israel. So, what if you're not all that religious? Let's get more down to earth, shall we? Let's talk about day-to-day life. Well, if you enjoy many of the conveniences of modern-day life, or a technophile, and are thankful for the era of microcomputing, then you should care about Israel. Let's take a look at technology. Like the cell phone, that was developed in Israel, Motorola. There's voicemail technology, iChat, instant messenger and phone texting. Who knew the Jews were such a chatty bunch? You know, most of Windows NT and XP operating systems were developed by Microsoft Israel. The Pentium MX chip, that was designed in Israel at Intel. Both the Pentium 4 microprocessor and Centrino processor, entirely designed, developed, and produced in Israel. Israel produces more scientific papers per capita than any other nation by a large margin. In fact, Israel leads in the number of patent filings per capita more than any other country. How about the economics? Israel's $100 billion economy is larger than all of its immediate neighbors combined. And Israel has the third highest rate of entrepreneurship and the highest rate among women and people over 55. Per capita, Israel has the largest number of startup companies in the world. Only the USA has more startups in real numbers. Outside the United States and Canada, Israel has the largest number of NASDAQ-listed companies. Israel is ranked number 2 in the world for venture capital funds, right behind the US. So how about lifestyle? You know, our personal freedom and individual responsibility form the foundation of this experiment we call the United States of America. And that's based on the Judeo-Christian heritage that comes to us from Israel. Our founding fathers understood the importance of faith and felt that the Christian faith in particular provided the foundation upon which a successful society could be formed. Our founding documents, the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution, the Federalist Papers, all reflect the fact that God was the cornerstone of a society built upon a personal freedom and individual responsibility. You know, even more so then, the Judeo-Christian religion informed and influenced these great men to make the choices that eventually created the greatest and most successful country in the history of the world. So thank you, Israel. And oh, by the way, along the way, while you're enjoying your lifestyle of freedom, don't forget to thank folks like Francis Salvador, the first patriot to die in the Revolutionary War. You may have never heard of Chaim Soloman from right here in New York. His fortune was freely given to George Washington and the Continental Congress at a time so critical in the battle that many believe it to be one of the deciding factors in victory. Chaim Soloman died penniless, never to be repaid. But thanks to those who listen to this presentation, never to be forgotten. I could go on for hours on the impact of Israel and the Jewish people on America, but for those of you with bad backs and are simply grateful that our patriotic march is not a goose step and that we don't have to wear those goofy little mustaches, you might consider, say, a tip of the hat to the dozens or so Jewish scientists who made it possible for our country, the United States of America, to prevail against an enemy alliance committed and completely capable of having won World War II. Politics. Now, keeping in mind how small and insignificant Israel is, both geographically and demographically, it's kind of interesting to note how in recent years, the Middle East was the subject of 76% of the country-specific General Assembly resolutions in the United Nations, and 40% of the Human Rights Council resolutions, and 6 out of 10 of their emergency sessions. You know, according to the UN, Zionism, which is the idea that Jewish people should be able to gather in their own homeland and govern themselves, is considered racism. The Palestinian representative to the UN Human Rights Commission claimed in 1997 that Israeli doctors had injected Palestinian children with the AIDS virus. You know, this same commission took several months to correct in its record a statement by the Syrian ambassador that Jews allegedly had killed non-Jewish children to make unleavened bread for Passover. An international legal scholar wrote once, "But there's never been a single resolution about the decades-long repression of the civil and political rights of 1.3 billion people in China, or the million female migrant workers in Saudi Arabia kept as virtual slaves, or as the virulent racism which has brought 600,000 people to the brink of starvation in Zimbabwe, not to mention their silence in Rwanda." The Organization of Islamic Conferences, OIC, holds 18 of the 47 seats on the UN Human Rights Council, with another dozen or so seats going to the nations that have 10 times higher concentration of Muslims than in the US. On average, this group votes against the United States about 84% of the time. Israel, on the other hand, votes with the U.S. nearly 90% of the time, year after year after year. That's nearly twice as good as Canada, and leaves Australia and even Great Britain way in the back. Why should I care about Israel? Let's see. How about because on the world stage today, they are our truest ally. Peace and war. Now, for as many people there are today that believe you can judge someone by their friends, there's an equal number who believe you can also judge someone by their enemies. In a few moments, I'm going to show you some staggering charts and historical perspectives and comparisons regarding war and peace. But just for now, how about some highlights? The enemy of my enemy is my friend. In the past, a decade of radical elements in the Mideast has unilaterally declared war on America, de facto making them our enemy. This same group of extremists has declared themselves the sworn enemy of Israel. So their enemy Israel is therefore our friend. That's all old news, I know. But did you know that our country's first war was actually with Israel's self-declared enemy? Did you know that the same enemy partnered with Hitler to kill millions in World War II? That Stalin's greatest generals were made up of Israel's enemy? And their divisions accounted for more human atrocities than in the history of most nations. How about Mao Zedong? He enlisted millions of Israel's self-declared enemy to whom he showed special favor, as they joined him in a death toll the likes of which the world has never seen. Well, why should I care about Israel? How about because Israel's self-declared enemy today is the greatest single threat of aggression against our nation and our way of life. But who is that enemy, really? Stick around, because we're going to go into extensive detail, facts, and statistics on this enemy, and I promise you that you're going to leave here a different person than the person who started. Hunger and suffering. Historically documented, at least since the Code of the Hammurabi in 2000 BC, some forms of slavery were already viewed as traditional and customary. Slavery could be voluntary servitude for economic purposes, or as a result of child abandonment or parental death, penance for crimes, or as a result of battle. Slaves were created out of every race, creed, culture, and every class of people. Now, despite the best efforts of our revisionist history in our education system today, slavery is not a white-on-black thing. In fact, the term slavery comes from the name Slav, for the white Slavic race, who were a highly prized possession. We'll talk more about Israel's self-declared enemy and their involvement in slavery in a few moments, but sufficient to say that they've been at the very center of the world's onslaught of slavery since the first millennium, and up to and including today. In fact, in Middle Eastern countries, the slave trade continued into the early 20th century. For example, slavery in Morocco was only outlawed in the 1930s. In the 1950s, Saudi Arabia had an estimated 450,000 slaves. That's 20% of their population. In Mauritania, in 1980, slavery was finally declared as legally ended. However, slavery today continues in various factions throughout the world's Mideast strongholds. Hunger. Well, of the poorest nations on the face of this planet, some of the largest of them are either controlled by or significantly influenced by those people who declare themselves enemies to Israel. Many citizens of these countries earn less than $100 per year. Now, when progressives talk about global redistribution, who do you suppose is weighting down that curve the most? You know, one of the foundational tenets of the nations who've set themselves squarely against Israel is the importance of charitable giving. It's referred sometimes as the zakat. The zakat requires an annual contribution of 2.5% of one's total wealth, not to be confused with 2.5% of their income, 2.5% of their total wealth. So tell me, with a mandate to hundreds of millions of people in oil-rich nations to pay 2.5% of their total wealth to charity, how is it that these lands are littered with the emaciated corpses of starved men, women, and children? For an example, 2.5% of the wealth of the Saudi Arabian royal family alone in 3 years could create enough charitable funds to feed the entire continents of Africa and Asia for more than a decade. Intolerance. You know, it goes hand in hand with a people group that define themselves as perennial enemies. If they'll kill Jews, Christians, Buddhists, and Hindus because they're different, you can bet that tolerance probably isn't one of their strong suits. But like our progressive friends, Israel's enemies cultivate their goals slowly, over time, until they have the power to simply accomplish their goals in total, without alliances, pretense, or facades. So why should we care about Israel? How about because, like our ally Israel, a common foe has made it their supreme goal in life, as they see it and clearly state it, to annihilate our very existence, or to die trying. But again, exactly who is that enemy? Well, let's get into the details, and I'll show you where we'll be heading. To make things a little easier, we've broken the vast amount of information into four different sections. We're going to be briefly covering the history of the state of Israel. Then we're going to go into the history of Islam. That's a very detailed look at exactly what is Islam. We'll learn a little bit about the Islamic cultures and the scriptures and traditions in the early days of the indigenous people of the region before Islam became a religion, and about their founder, the leader, Muhammad, and finally about the spread and growth of Islam itself. The next section will cover the influence of Islam. And finally, we'll close out the presentation with a look at the end times.
On May 16, 2011, the New York Times published an op-ed titled "The Long Overdue Palestinian State" by Mahmoud Abbas, president of the Palestinian National Authority. In that piece, Abbas called for the United Nations to formally recognize a Palestinian state based on the pre-1967 borders, regardless of negotiations with the State of Israel. The article appeared just a few days before Barack Obama's much-anticipated speech on the Arab Spring, in which the president also tried to jumpstart peace negotiations between Israel and the Palestinian Authority. To reach an agreement on a two-state solution, Obama declared, Israel must agree to return to the pre-1967 borders, modified only by mutually agreed land swaps. Now, neither Mr. Abbas nor Mr. Obama can explain how anyone could have recognized a United Nations-designated Palestinian state that Palestinian leaders and the Arab states themselves have rejected. Of the troubles in Ireland, the poet William Butler Yeats once wrote, "Great hatred, little room, maimed us at the start." In Palestine at the start, there was plenty of room, more than enough room, for a prosperous Jewish state and a prosperous Arab state. After World War I ended, with the dismantling of the Ottoman Empire, the League of Nations established the Mandate for Palestine, including all of the land that is now Israel, the West Bank, and the Gaza Strip, plus the entire territory east of the Jordan River, now called the Kingdom of Jordan. The area under the mandate was as large as Syria and about half as large as Iraq, yet the total population at the time was less than 1 million, of whom 10% were Jews. It was in that vast, underdeveloped, and underpopulated territory that the British had promised in the language of the 1917 Balfour Declaration to support the establishment in Palestine of a national home for the Jewish people. The declaration also promised that nothing shall be done which may prejudice the civil and religious rights of existing non-Jewish communities in Palestine. Open Jewish immigration to the Holy Land was encouraged, as was freedom of speech, religion, and assembly for the Arabs of Palestine, rights they had sorely lacked under Turkish rule. Mired for more than two centuries in backwardness and grinding poverty, Palestinians were never recognized by the Ottoman Empire as possessing any distinctive national identity. The Palestinians quickly took advantage of their new freedom to speak bluntly, demanding a stop to the Jewish immigration, which had just begun. Said one Arab representative during the Paris Peace Conference, "We will push the Zionists into the sea, or they will send us back into the desert." Aref Pasha Dajani, a Palestinian leader from Jerusalem, warned that it is impossible to live with the Jews. In all the countries where they are at present, they are not wanted because they always arrive to suck the blood of everybody. If the League of Nations will not listen to the appeal of the Arabs, this country will become a river of blood. Well, as promised, blood did flow when the Palestinian demand to end Jewish immigration was not granted. Jerusalem was the first flashpoint for regular Arab attacks on Jewish communities in April 1920. Palestinians from nearby towns poured into the old city. The Muslim mayor of Jerusalem and other notables worked up the crowd to launch a jihad against the Jews. "If we don't use force against the Zionists and against the Jews, we will never be rid of them," urged newspaper editor Arif al-Arif. The crowd shouted back, "We will drink the blood of the Jews." Shouting Islamic slogans like "Muhammad's religion was born with the sword," thousands surged through the Jewish quarter and into West Jerusalem. The mobs vented their rage against any Jew they could find, burning and looting homes and stores, and even attacking British and Arab policemen. After several days of rioting, the final toll was 6 Jews dead, hundreds beaten, and widespread destruction of property. What became known as the Nebi Musa riot was the opening shot in a 90-year war to reverse the Balfour Declaration. And things soon got worse as the Allies, to assuage the fears of Arab monarchs, separated the land east of the Jordan River out of the total area accessible to Jewish immigrants and created the Emirate of Transjordan. Reconciling the aspirations of Arabs and Jews became far more tenuous after the Balfour Declaration had to be carried out in the truncated area of Palestine from the Jordan River to the Mediterranean Sea. There was now much less room and a great deal more hatred. The decades that followed were marred by perpetual violence against the Jews, both in Palestine and in Europe. The two were often linked. Under the leadership of the Grand Mufti and President of the Supreme Muslim Council, Haj Amin al-Husseini, the Arabs of Palestine waged an endless jihad against their Jewish neighbors. When the British sent a royal commission to investigate a solution, the Jews, represented by Chaim Weizmann, pressed for a partition of the territory into two states, even if the territory assigned to the Jews was the size of a tablecloth. The Peel Commission's final report, published in July 1937, proposed such a division. The Jews were offered an independent state in a small enclave along the seacoast from Tel Aviv to the north of the country, constituting about 20% of the remaining mandate territory, while the Palestinian Arabs would get 80% for their own state. Desperate for any means to be able to bring in large numbers of the endangered European Jews, the Zionists reluctantly accepted the Commission's partition plan. Led by the Mufti, the Arabs rejected partition out of hand and pressed on with the armed revolt against the mandate. The British succeeded in putting down the violence for a time. Al-Husseini was sent into exile, ultimately, in Hitler's Nazi Germany, where he lived as a special guest of the Führer. But severe limitations were placed on Jewish immigration to the Holy Land in the years leading up to the Holocaust that undoubtedly directly led to the death of many thousands of European Jews. Now, following the atrocities of the Second World War, Britain relinquished authority over the mandate to the newly formed United Nations. The UN created yet another commission to try to figure out what to do with the contested territory. The United Nations Special Committee on Palestine recommended, by a vote of 7-3, yet another two-state solution, another partition plan to the General Assembly. This plan would have seen the territory divided almost equally between Jews and Arabs. Once again, the Zionists made public their acceptance of the proposal, and once again, Arab officials announced that any partition would be met with rivers of blood. Shortly after the UN vote, the 20-member Arab League sent their newly organized Arab Liberation Army against the Jews of Palestine. Elements of 5 regular Arab armies from Egypt, Jordan, Syria, Iraq, and Lebanon invaded Israel on May 15, 1948. Arab League Secretary General Abdul Rahman Azzam vowed, "This will be a war of extermination and a momentous massacre which will be spoken of like the Mongol massacres and the Crusades. But despite their overwhelming numbers and heated rhetoric, after a year of fighting, it was the Jewish state that had won a decisive victory. Based on the 1949 armistice lines, Israel's territory expanded by almost 40%. The Palestinian Arabs were the big losers. For the second time in 10 years, their leaders rejected a partition plan that would have given them independence and more land designated for their state than for the Jewish state. Instead, they ended up with nothing, and 650,000 Palestinians became refugees. Jordan's King Abdullah sent his Arab Legion to occupy the Palestinian West Bank and annex the territory to his kingdom. Egypt took the Gaza Strip and for the next 18 years denied Palestinians any civil rights. It never occurred to the rulers of Jordan or Egypt to create a state for the homeless Palestinians, nor did new Palestinian leaders like Yasser Arafat protest this occupation of their land by foreign rulers. Now, three times in the past decade, Israeli prime ministers have offered Palestinian leaders an independent state far more generous than anything Jordan and Egypt ever allowed when they controlled the West Bank and Gaza. At Camp David in 2000, Israeli Prime Minister Ehud Barak agreed to the border suggested by President Clinton that would have established a West Bank Gaza Palestinian state with some territorial adjustments and with the Palestinians getting East Jerusalem as their capital. For his part, Palestinian Liberation Organization Chairman Yasser Arafat walked out of negotiations, went back home, and launched the Second Intifada. Invoking Islamic Jew hatred as justification, the Palestinians conducted a three-year brutal campaign of suicide bombings against Israeli pizza parlors, wedding halls, and discotheques. In 2005, Israeli Prime Minister Ariel Sharon decided that it was against Israel's security interest to govern the 1.1 million Palestinians in the Gaza Strip. Sharon dismantled all of the Jewish settlements and pulled Israeli forces back across the 1967 borders between Israel and Gaza without even any land swaps. As an added bonus, Israel left the Palestinians a thriving flour export industry to help jumpstart the local economy. The Palestinians' response to this generosity? Well, first they destroyed the donated greenhouses and then they launched a war of missiles and rockets against civilian targets in Israel. In a September 2008 meeting in Jerusalem, then-Israeli Prime Minister Ehud Olmert presented President Abbas with a detailed map of a future Palestinian state that, with land swaps, would constitute close to 100% of the territory of the West Bank and Gaza prior to the June 1967 war. Olmert also offered to divide Jerusalem, enabling the Palestinians to locate their capital in the eastern half of the city. Promising to come back the next day for further discussions, Abbas took Olmert's map to his Ramallah office, just a few miles outside Jerusalem, for his aides to study. But Abbas never returned with the map. This was the last time the Israeli and Palestinian leaders met. Many times over the last 63 years, both the international community and the State of Israel have offered the Arabs of Palestine their own state. Each time, these offers have been met by more violence against Jewish citizens. Neither President Abbas nor President Obama are ignorant of this fact. They simply both choose to ignore it. For Mr. Abbas, this refusal seems to be part of a consistent thread woven throughout the Arab war against the Jews. Mr. Obama's positions remain more mysterious.
Our next topic is the history of Islam. In this section, we'll be looking at what is Islam, scriptures of Islam, the pre-Islamic culture before Muhammad was born, the life of Muhammad, the founder of Islam, and finally, the spread of Islam. Many people would have the world believe that America fears or hates Islam or Muslims. So they coin terms like Islamophobia or Islamofascist. The concern over being tainted by either aspersion keeps most people away from truly exploring the rich and diverse tapestry of human history and development that has been influenced by Islam. There's no doubt there's a wide cultural and civilization gap, but just like it's inappropriate for the media or Muslims to label America as a fearful or evil nation based on what some individual American citizens might think, say, or do, it's also wrong for anyone to characterize Islam by what individual Muslims might think or do. The term Islam was first coined in the scriptures, revered by Muslims, the Quran, and by their God Allah. It says, "This day have I perfected for you your religion, and completed my favor on you, and chosen for you Islam as a religion." Holy Quran, Surah Al-Mahdi 5:3. The word Islam is actually translated to mean submission or relinquish, and the name Muslim means one who submits or relinquishes. Today, approximately 1.7 billion people regard themselves as Muslims. And before we get started, I want to make this point that Muslims are simply people. No two are exactly alike, just like Buddhists, Christians, or Jews. Each is an individual. Being a Muslim is understood as following the precepts of Islam. That involves a religious nature, a political ideology, a cultural lifestyle, and a set of legal regulations. Now, not all Muslims live Islam to the same degree or devotion. Some follow it closely, and some kind of just skate by. Just like each of us probably knows someone who considers themselves Christian or Jewish or Methodist, but don't pray or attend church, may battle addictions, or maybe they fall into sin on a regular basis. As Christians, we're told to love all people, but hate the sin. In the Christian religion, and in the West generally, we judge something as a sin based on its deviation from the rules, the traditions, and the descriptions found in the scriptures. So those are the elements that form the expected baseline for behavior. Now, based on those behaviors, we can determine how devoted a Christian is to Christianity, or a Buddhist is to Buddhism, and a Muslim is to Islam. We all follow at different levels, and devotion is an individual thing. No one knows the heart of a man or a woman. It's not for us to judge Christian, Jew, Buddhist, Muslim, or atheist. But because the belief system that these adherents strive to uphold is well established through scriptures, doctrine, tradition, and practice, we can and do compare and contrast them. That's natural. Therefore, we can make logical assessments about them. We can determine how devoted and how closely a Muslim follows the dictates of Islam. Let's run through some of the foundational elements upon which Islam is built. First, we'll start with the Quran. The Quran is to Islam what the Bible is to Christians. Islam states that the Quran is a perfect transcription of what Allah, the name used by Islam to refer to God, communicated to their prophet Muhammad through the angel Gabriel. Some of this occurred while Muhammad was in a cave in the Middle East during the early part of the 7th century. Muhammad could not write, so these words were reportedly memorized and eventually written down much later by scribes. The Quran contains 114 chapters called surahs. These chapters are not ordered chronologically or even thematically. The Quran, a word which means to recite, is supposed to be read and remain only in its original language. According to Islam, that language, Arabic. But translations exist for hundreds of languages today, and we'll talk more about the implications of that later on. The hadiths and the sunnahs are writings about Muhammad, referred to as the messenger. And the hadiths are his words, sayings, and stories of his actions. The sunnah is a subset of that, more specifically isolating his acts, his practices, and tacit approvals, thereby setting up the standard by which followers were to be measured. The sirah refers to his accepted biographies created by his followers. Sharia law is a body of writings derived, interpreted, and then modified by Islamic leaders over the centuries to create a complete legal infrastructure governing family, economies, crime, religion, and even politics. The rules and the punishments are specifically and meticulously spelled out for those who deviate from the prescribed practices. Islam teaches that Sharia law is to be instituted worldwide, and it's incumbent on all Muslims to help to make that a reality. The five pillars. They're kind of a handy shorthand to give you an understanding of the general requirements of a follower of Islam. They include the creed, or a shahada, which when spoken in earnest is the equivalent of an initiation into the religion. It goes, there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his messenger. Many recognize the second pillar of prayer, or Salat. Islam teaches to pray prostrate on one's knees, facing the direction of Mecca. Now, they take that command quite seriously. There's even an entire Islamic organization whose purpose is to calculate exactly what direction that is from any location on earth, including a computerized mapping technology, praying five times each day, or at least on Friday the Sabbath. Then there's the fasting, or the psalm, which includes food, drink, and sex, and it's viewed as a penance and a cleansing process. It's mandatory for most during the holy celebration of Ramadan. The pilgrimage, or the Hajj, is a trip to Mecca, which Islam requires a follower to make sometime before their death. There's a rather long list of unusual rituals surrounding the trip once at the holy site, which is called the Kaaba. We'll talk more about that in a few moments. Finally, a zakat, which is almsgiving. However, instead of prescribing a percentage of one's income, the zakat is based on 2.5% of one's total wealth. Finally, much like the Christian doctrinal differences that created the many denominations today we see in Christianity, Islam has its schisms and sects as well. Although the core tenets of the faith, known as Aqidah, are pretty much the same for all followers. The Sunnis comprise about 80 to 85%, and the Shia make up the difference. Much like the Christian faith, the schism happened over a falling out over who should become the successor of Muhammad after his death. Sunnis thought it should be chosen by the community leaders, and the minority Shia felt it should be in the family lineage of the messenger Muhammad. Although there's no actual priesthood per se, there is a functional hierarchy which guides the social, political, and religious order. The caliph and ayatollah are considered the holy interpreters of Islam. The mufti and imams follow them and are leaders based on various criteria, including the knowledge of the scriptures. From these documents, history, traditions, and practices, we'll be able to fairly assess and come to some logical conclusions about Islam based on what we learn here today. You'll be able to assess how devoted and regimented a Muslim is in their practice of Islam, because Islam is knowable and definable. But remember, the heart of a man is not. So, where did all of this come from? Today, Muslims who practice Islam can be found in virtually all races and nationalities across the globe. But it hasn't always been that way. Just like Christendom began with the Semitic people of the Mideast, Islam came into existence with its own ethnic heritage. So let's begin by discussing where the first Muslims came from. We'll use the Bible to give us some historical reference. We'll start with Adam and Eve, and then Noah and the Ark, followed by Abraham, Jacob, and who later was named Israel, of course, and then King David, and finally, Daniel. According to Islam, Muhammad is a descendant of Abraham through his son, Ishmael. This is a pivotal point for Islam, as they make the case that Islam, along with Muhammad and his followers, originated from the same patriarchal line as the Jews and Christians. Some believe that this spiritual lineage to Islam was chosen with the intention of establishing credibility and common ground based on a common Abrahamic heritage. Although no documented family lineage or other credible historical references support the claim of ancestry to Ishmael, including Muhammad specifically stating that any genealogy attributed to him beyond 500 years is a lie. So, still most traditions in academia and media simply accept and repeat that assertion on and on. Now, here's a problem with that. Abraham was only great because of the way God dealt with him. It was not the man, but rather God's relationship with the man, a man named Abram, and God's covenant through him to his son Isaac and Jacob, also known as Israel. That's the key to the Bible. That special spiritual covenant. It continued on through to Jesus, paving the way for Christendom. It's this important covenant upon which the Bible is based, and not the ancestry of a simple man named Abram. Ishmael, on the other hand, was actually born to Hagar, a pagan concubine, presented to Abram by the Egyptian pharaoh, who was also a pagan. Now, although the Bible tells us that Abram was the father of Ishmael, the significance of the Bible is God and his covenant, not the man Abram. That covenant was established through Abraham and Sarah and through their son Isaac. So Abram became Abraham and Sarai became Sarah nearly 2 decades after Ishmael was born. So God's covenant is not actually shared by Ishmael. In fact, the Bible is quite explicit and tells of a promise made to Ishmael's mother, Hagar, regarding her son. Behold, you are with child and shall bear a son. You shall call his name Ishmael, because the Lord has given heed to your affliction. He shall be a wild ass of a man, his hand against every man, and every man's hand against him. And he shall dwell over and against all his kinsmen. Genesis 16:11. Compare that to the blessing through Abraham, Isaac, and Israel. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on the earth will be blessed through you. Now, in fact, from a spiritual perspective, when reading the Bible, it seems rather odd that anyone could claim a common spiritual ancestry with Judaism or Christianity by citing a common ancestry with Ishmael. No such spiritual common ground exists. Simply a relationship with a man named Abram, whom God later called into relationship with himself and renamed Abraham. A closer historical and anthropological review may shed some light on perhaps a different spiritual ancestry. Let's take a look at the actual people group from which Islam actually sprouted. In this case, we can see from the Islamic scriptures that Muhammad and his early followers were from the Arab people group known as the Quraysh tribe. The majority of the Arab people are referred to as having a Hamitic ancestry. In order to understand what Hamitic means and where that comes from, we're going to have to go back a little bit in time. If you recall the history of the Great Flood, Noah built an ark so that his family, including his 3 sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth, along with lots of animals, could survive and repopulate the earth. This is where we get the term Hamitic. That would refer to the ancestry derived from Ham, the son of Noah. You know, you may recognize that Shem, that name, it's the root of the Hebrew word for Semite or Semitic. That's where it comes from. These are the ancestors of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, who's better known as Israel, to whom God made a special covenant. And it's within this same lineage of Shem, through whom the Messiah Jesus in Christian religion was born centuries later, exactly as it was prophesied. In Deuteronomy 28:7, the Bible tells us of a great blessing on Shem and Japheth. But Ham did not share in that blessing. Well, why is that? Some of you may recall the story about Ham in the Bible, you know, in Genesis 9, which has a brief narrative about an offense committed by Ham upon Noah, who'd become drunk with wine and lay asleep unclothed in his tent. Ham tells his brothers of having been in the presence of his father in this condition, which is generally understood, although no sordid details are given in the scriptures, that some serious moral offense to Noah had occurred in the tent. Both Shem and Japheth grabbed a cloak and entered their father's tent backwards and covered their father. According to the Hebrew Bible interpretation, Noah spoke a curse not directly on Ham, but rather on Ham's sons and descendants. But at any rate, an immoral act committed by Ham created a curse that stemmed through the lineage of Ham. Part of that curse was that Ham's descendants, they'd serve his brother's ancestors. Ham's descendants eventually emigrated to Egypt. And coincidentally, we later find through historical archaeology that the Egyptian word for slave was Hem. Ham's sons, Canaan, Cush, Put, and Mizraim, settled elsewhere. Canaan, for example, founded a large city which was renowned for how it became entrenched in pagan idol worship and all forms of sexual immorality and perversions. Mizraim is the Hebrew word for Egypt, which is where the Jewish nation was led into captivity and then held by Egyptian pagan idol worshippers. Mizraim fathered Philistim, which is the eponym for the tribe that became the Philistines. According to the Bible, their similar debauchery and departure from God's way memorialized them as one of the greatest enemies of God's chosen people, Israel. These were the Hamitic tribes. According to the Bible, this is the ancestry of the Egyptian and the Arab people groups. Clearly, Ham's descendants appear to have lived up to their role as a black sheep of Noah's family. So let's start here and see if we can find a spiritual ancestry or heritage. By following this ancestry a bit further, we also come upon a story of Nimrod and the building of the Tower of Babel. In Genesis 10:8, a translation will show Nimrod, meaning rebel, was a tyrannical hunter warrior opposing Yahweh, the God of the Jews, and persecuting his people. Babel was also the first recorded attempt to establish a one-world government and a one-world religion. Nimrod was an idol worshiper, and his god was named Baal. Keep that in the back of your mind for a few moments. But according to the Bible, we can see that the ancestry of Ham certainly appeared to live down to its expectations. So, what were those original pagan religious traditions of Ham's offspring throughout time? Before we go any further, it's valuable to keep in mind that much of the science, myths, religions, and rituals of early tribes had to do with the mysteries of nature, especially those in the sky. The lead roles were normally played by the sun, the moon, and the morning star, or Venus. Mercury, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn sort of rounded out the big seven. Sometimes the sun was the main god, and sometimes it was the moon. And then the next brightest light, which was Venus. That usually played a dominant role as well. Some of the earliest of the Hamitic people were the Sumerians and the surrounding tribes, who worshipped a god named Nana and the god Suen, who showed homage to a moon deity, as you can see, represented by a crescent-shaped moon here. Inanna was his daughter. She was denoted by a star, or the Venus. The crescent is significant because it's always the first sighting of the moon, and it's the only definite and identifiable return or rebirth of the moon on a monthly basis. Eventually, Sumerians were destroyed by the Babylonians, but versions of those pagan traditions continued and included sacrifices to Baal, also worshiping the moon god, whom they called Sin. The Semites derived their term Sin from this early god, and based on their location, the name Sinai was coined. The Babylonians revered a god named Ishtar, a star represented by Venus, which is also referred to as the morning star at dawn, because the only time it can be seen is just before sunrise or just after sunset on the horizon. Hundreds of years later, in Canaan, Baal was still going strong, and according to the Bible, sexual immorality had degenerated so much that God told the Israelites to utterly destroy them. However, the Canaanites were not the only members of Ham's descendants that continued to worship the moon deities, including the growing empires like Nebuchadnezzar and then Nabonidus, whose mother was actually the high priestess for the moon goddess. The Persian Medes eventually conquered the Babylonian Empire, and as the Bedouins began to migrate and further open trade routes, the names and rituals of the moon gods and star religions varied, including Tammuz, Ma, Wad, Am, Muka, and Ubal. But their symbolism remained virtually unchanged, the crescent moon and the morning star, or as we may refer to it, Venus. This imagery continued to represent the idolatry and adulteries of the peoples of the Bible over many, many centuries of time. It's this pagan spiritual ancestry that sets the tone and foundation into which Islam would then be introduced in the Middle East. Now, was Islam successful in eradicating this 4,000-year-long history of pagan idolatry, or did it merely become a new vehicle for a long-standing tradition? Today, Islam is identified by these very same symbols, the crescent moon and the star. But to truly know why, we need to learn more. Now, let's learn about Muhammad and his life. We'll start with Muhammad's father, Abdallah ibn Abd al-Muttalib, Yeah, I know that's quite a mouthful, but just for a moment, let's look at the first part of the name. It's quite telling. Abdallah. That name means the servant or slave of Allah. Being named in honor of a deity referred to as Allah long happened before Muhammad was born, and it was quite common. Whether it was a proper name or an honorific title like the Lord represents some controversy, but as we move forward, we'll see how this piece fits in and becomes more obvious. Abdallah and his ancestors were already in the religion business with a god the pagans called Allah, long before Muhammad was born. You see, as members of the Quraysh tribe, it was their tribal families that controlled the operations and the local commerce created by pagan pilgrimage and travel to the religious structure called the Kaaba, located in Mecca. This Kaaba in Mecca, like the many other competing Kaabas in the region, was a very simple stone or brick structure. These shrine centers served as nomadic way stations along the growing trade routes. However, they were most important as gathering centers for pagan religious rituals. Control over these centers were highly prized and often the underlying cause of many tribal wars. This pagan religious center in Mecca housed 360 different deities, sort of the Baskin-Robbins of the day. In addition to bull or calf gods, there were numerous other symbols and artifacts that served as gods. It was common that physical objects were viewed as being imbued with, inhabited by, or actually were the presence of a god. This pagan belief or practice is referred to as animism. But by far, the dominant symbolism was that of the ancient sun, moon, and star pagan religions, very similar to the Hamitic traditions from thousands of years earlier. In particular, the moon deity. That was a special note in Mecca. Although the crescent moon consistently served as the root symbolism, other representations and names were also plentiful. According to the Islamic Hadith, the name of the main moon god in Mecca was referred to as Allah, and like many other star and moon religions, Allah had three daughters. In the case of Mecca, they were named Al-Uzza, also sometimes referred to as Allah's wife, and two other daughters, Alat and Al-Manat. We can see the prominence and influence of the moon deity in what is called the Black Stone, which is depicted as the source of creation and how it was revered at the Kaaba. It was actually prominently located on the outside of the Kaaba and attached, almost like the cornerstone of the structure. Its symbolism is unmistakable. It represents the creative force or origin of human creation in the image of female genitalia. Before Islam, pagans would disrobe and circle the Kaaba, kissing the stone, and then retreat to a separate area, still unclothed, and consummate or engage in procreative sexual acts. No doubt that this provocative and erotic activity played a very large role in the success of the Hajj, and the value of control of Mecca. More than a dozen other specific pagan rituals like this are still enacted by millions of Muslims each and every year on the Hajj, as they're directed to do by Islam and its scriptures and traditions. The Black Stone was venerated by Muhammad's kissing of the stone and thereby carrying on the pagan traditions. Islam scriptures were later written that stated that the Black Stone, which fell from the moon, was lost in the desert, but found again by Hagar and Ishmael while in the desert. Quran 2:125 states that Ishmael and Abraham then incorporated the stone while they built the Kaaba together, sort of a father-son project, if you will. Well, the problem here is that this story conflicts directly with Muhammad's account in the Hadith that specifically states that the Kaaba was built 40 years before Solomon's temple, around 951 BC. Naturally, at that time, Abraham and Ishmael would have been dead for, 1,000 years? And everybody knows how being dead puts a damper on father-son projects. Perhaps the selection of Ishmael as a patriarch had more to do with the pagan mother Hagar. Interestingly, the name for Hagar in Arabic is Hajar, and the Arabic name for the Black Stone is Hajar al-Aswad. Well, there's no doubt that Mecca was an interesting place for Muhammad to grow up. Although Muhammad would later make lofty claims about Mecca's ancient heritage and spiritual uniqueness, that may have had more to do with Mecca being part of the family business than actual historical truth. According to the Quran, Muhammad's own Quraysh tribe actually took their annual pilgrimages to other Kaabas that were considered more important at the time. Although today all Muslims face Mecca during their prayer, the actual history behind Mecca is much more revealing as to Muhammad's start of Islam. Almost all researchers agree that there's no historical record of Mecca existing prior to the 4th century AD, and no records of a Kaaba until around the 5th century. There were numerous maps and catalogs of much smaller tribal regions, but no mention of Mecca. So then, what is the history of Mecca? Historical records show us that a sheikh named Asab Abu Karb, who was the reigning monarch of the Himyarite kingdom far to the south in Yemen, was looking to extend his empire over the central western Arabian market. His goal was actually to control the growing spice route from Yemen to North Arabia and then on into the Fertile Crescent. Believe it or not, frankincense and myrrh were quite the hot commodity. Abu Karb's kingdom conquered the rich and prosperous kingdom of Sheba, from which we find the records of the pagan religious group called Sabians. Abu Karb eventually occupied the cities of central western Arabia at the beginning of the 5th century AD. Among those cities were Mecca and Yathrib, also called Al-Madinah. This occupier's strategy was simple. It was to bind these cities to his kingdom by reinforcing the Yemeni religious system of the Sabians, which the inhabitants of Mecca and Medina were already embracing. It was easy since many of the inhabitants of Mecca had originally emigrated from Yemen in the 2nd century after a natural disaster of a dam breaking sometime around 150 AD. So Abu Karb was already familiar with their religious beliefs. In fact, many believe that Mecca was named after the Sabians' main god, Al-Makkah. This plan was to have the tribe of the Khuza build the Kaabas and then create the centers, thereby gaining the allegiance of the local tribes. However, in Medina, in addition to two main Yemeni tribes, the Oaz and the Khazraj, there were also two large Jewish tribes, including the Beni Karita and the Beni Natir. To accomplish his ends, Abu Karb brought two Jewish rabbis to Yemen. They added to his knowledge by teaching him many Judaic religious rites and myths, enabling him to mix various items of his own Yemeni pagan background with Jewish mythology and religious tradition. For example, he combined Arabian star worship with Jewish myths and stories from the Old Testament. With a mixed knowledge like this, he planned to create a hybrid religious practice that included the Jewish traditions, the new Christian beliefs and writings, and the rituals of the pagans. If he could earn their allegiance by controlling these religious centers, the Kaabas, then he knew he'd eventually be able to control and gain the entire central western region of Arabia. Abu Karb took the information he gathered from the rabbis and then claimed himself to be a prophet and expounding many thoughts which the Yemeni people considered indisputable about the sun, the earth, and the cosmos. Muhammad later adapted many of these teachings into his own version of religious teachings. The Khuza eventually lost control of Mecca to the Quraysh tribe, which was the tribe into which Muhammad was born. Like Abu Karb, Muhammad was holding himself out as Allah's prophet. Islamic history reports that for a long time, Muhammad was shunned except for a few family members. Ben Abi Salat, Muhammad's cousin, and a poet, was a member of a small sect called Hanifa, who was one of the first to join Muhammad. The Hanifa were a Yemeni sect that claimed a monotheistic heritage with the God of Abraham. Ben Ali donned the garb of prophet for a short while, but with very little success. He had a difficult time gathering a following, and he eventually abandoned his claim and later lent his experience and his writings to Muhammad, who spent the majority of his life deeply ensconced in the pagan practices of the day. So with these foundations of failed prophets before him, Muhammad set out as a prophet with a goal to develop an all-inclusive monotheistic version of religion which encompassed the rich heritage of the Jewish tradition and a hint of that new fad of the Christian movement, yet still maintaining virtually all of the traditional pagan practices and their symbols and their rituals. This inclusive, tolerant approach would later change, but in the beginning, familiarity and common ground were the best hope in order to gain followers. It wasn't until Muhammad had a brief meeting with a handful of tribal leaders that his efforts began to show some real fruits. There were two tribes, Oaz and Khazraj, who met with Muhammad at Mecca. They were known for their frivolity and, frankly, thievery. Muhammad is quoted as once referring to these two tribes as licentious. There's very little detail on his brief meeting with the representatives from these two tribal gangs, but what happened next speaks volumes. The leaders of these tribes indoctrinated their followers, swearing an allegiance to Muhammad. Now, even though there was little or no religious indoctrination of any kind, the allegiance of the Oaz and Khazraj in a formal alliance, referred to as the Pledge of Aqaba, became the turning point for Islam. If spiritual enlightenment was not the cause of this alliance, then some other form of incentive or motivation was used to mobilize this licentious band of Arabs to follow Muhammad. Well, the Hadith state that Muhammad offered them blood for blood and a promise of paradise. Al-Halabi, a biographer of Muhammad, reports on the reaction of the Arabian tribes towards Muhammad's offer to them to embrace Islam, saying, if they would do this, Muhammad guaranteed to give them the children of the tribes they conquered as slaves, and their wives and daughters as concubines. Well, what actually happened was that within a brief time, Muhammad was received by these two tribes, emigrated to Medina. Once in power there, Muhammad drove the Jewish tribe of Beni Nadir from the city. He besieged their settlements and prohibited food from reaching them, and the lack of food made them yield to him. So Muhammad took their houses, furniture, fields, all their gold, money, weapons, and once they deported them from the city, the Jewish tribe of Beni Nadir was no more. It went to Syria. Later, Muhammad besieged the second Jewish tribe, Beni Karita, and prohibited food and water from reaching them until they were compelled to yield to his judgment as well. Muhammad claimed that the judgment of Allah was on them. Now, all the males over 10 years of age were killed, and the males under 10 became slaves. The houses and the females of the tribe were divided and given to Muhammad's followers, the Oaz and Khazraj, and to the Muslims who followed him from Mecca. When it came to killing the males over 10 years of age, Muhammad ordered trenches to be dug. The males were fettered and brought in groups to the trenches, where they were beheaded and buried. He then divided the females and gave them as concubines to the members of the two tribes, Oaz and Khazraj. Older women with small children were sold as slaves in Damascus. As would become his custom, Muhammad took one-fifth of everything for himself, that is, from all the spoil of the females, of the children's slaves, and of the money, houses, and lands. This then set the pattern of what would become the fastest-growing religion on earth. Bedouin vagrants, warlords, and general ne'er-do-wells could suddenly wrap themselves in the righteousness of Allah and gain wealth beyond their wildest dreams, while enjoying the spoils of sexual immoralities of concubines and sex slaves. Muhammad participated in more than 70 such raids and attacks, with only one that could be considered defensive. The Islamic scriptures tell us that he personally oversaw beheadings of hundreds. The sexual gratification and plunder played a large role in the growing ranks and reputation of the Islamic hordes. Their risk of death, not only that, even offered a martyr's reward that highlighted the sexual gratification from numerous virgins for all eternity. You know, there are many points of Muhammad's biography that most Muslims concede are true, which you may find a bit controversial, like his 15 wives and innumerable sex slaves, and his brutal and unflinching practice of ending a life for little more than an insult. His marriage to a 6-year-old girl, with whom he later consummated when she was only 9 years old. You know, Muhammad's life story is one of the core foundational tenets of Islam. although I find it quite difficult, it's not my goal to characterize Muhammad's actions as inherently evil or nefarious. Facts simply are what they are. However, my concern is that the Quran demands emulating the role model of Muhammad. Here's what the Quran says about following Muhammad's example. Muhammad is an excellent role model for you to follow. In 33:31, it says, "If you love Allah, then follow Muhammad, and Allah will forgive your sins." Which sins? 33:36, "Rules and examples set by Allah and Muhammad are binding to all Muslims. There are no alternatives." And then 6:33, "Rejecting Muhammad is rejecting Allah." No, there was ample motivation for the spread of Islam, as we've seen. A restless and warring nomadic lifestyle in a poor country, for some, was easily transformed into a holy jihad, where Muhammad's followers reaped the benefits of plunder, slaves, and unbridled sexual conquest around every corner. And eventually, Muhammad established a more progressive social model. Now, instead of selling a slave only once and killing all of those who might later take revenge upon Muhammad's warriors, they created subjugation, and that became the rule of the day. In other words, to submit or relinquish, which happens to be the very meaning of the term Islam. This practice allowed warriors to move on to their next atrocity, while other Muslims who were satisfied with what they'd already acquired through plunder could then retire and settle in the newly conquered area and rule that new land. A second-class citizenry called a dhimmi was established, which allowed those spared their lives to pay a special perpetual tax called the jizya, which applied to only non-Muslims. Thus, an empire, better known as the caliphate, was born. By the way, after Muhammad's death, many of the Oaz and Khazraj tribesmen showed the true nature of their conversion when they decided to continue their newfound trade of terror and mayhem on their own, and they were the first to suffer the punishment that would eventually become known as Islamic apostasy. This in Islam means leaving the faith. Apostasy makes it the duty of all good Muslims to kill an apostate wherever they may be. In fact, in most Islamic countries today, there's still no penalty for such killing. Most of these facts that I've told you can be found in these documents. So tell me, how can a religion built on these kinds of foundations not simply crumble to the ground? First of all, we must remember that history is written or hidden by the victor. The Islamic conquest was both swift and complete, and with more power came more propaganda and religious rhetoric to assuage the shame or guilt of its adherents while inspiring the commitment of new recruits. With the life of Muhammad in mind, let's now take another look at the foundations of Islam with a fresh set of open eyes. The Quran. Well, the Quran is the perfect word of Allah, and yet it's filled with historical, logical, and geographical inaccuracies. These mistakes number into the hundreds. One of the most well-known mistakes is that the earth is flat, and it was created before the universe even existed. Also, according to the Quran, Mary, the mother of Jesus, was the daughter of Imran and sister of Aaron. You see, the problem with that is that Aaron was the brother of Moses, who lived like 1,200 years earlier. Muhammad tried to explain those two mistakes, but neither he nor later Muslims have succeeded. Scientists agree that Muhammad made a mistake here, either when he created it or when he recited it. So today, is critical analysis and study with an inquisitive mind encouraged in Islam? You know, seek and ye shall find. Actually, quite the opposite. In Quran 5:101, it says, "Believers, ask not questions about things which, if made plain to you, may cause you trouble when the Quran is revealed." Some people before you ask questions, and on that account, lost their faith. Maududi, in his commentary, The Meaning of the Quran, explains, "The Prophet forbade people to ask questions or to pry into such things. The Hadith confirms this prophetic warning in Bukhari. I heard the Prophet say, Allah has hated you for asking too many questions. Also, the best protection for Islam for a long time was the fact that the Quran only existed in the Arabic language, and the literacy rates were pretty poor. It remains one of the last bastions of defense for Muslims who state that the Quran can only be understood when read in its original classic Arab language. Like Abu Ka'b, that we discussed a few moments ago, the likely builder of the Kaaba in Mecca, there was yet another prophet. And that prophet also claimed knowledge of the true religion. His name was Zayd ibn Amir. He was also a Hanif. Now, even though Zayd was a skilled poet and a scribe, he too, like other self-proclaimed prophets of the day, was unable to gather a following amongst the deeply ritualized pagan Arabs. His work preceded Muhammad's rise to prophet status, and much of his early writings and styling prior to joining Muhammad were virtually identical to what Muhammad presented as the earliest surahs of the Quran, which, according to Islam, existed only as the word spoken by Allah through the angel Gabriel. Abrogation. Well, as I mentioned before, there are only 114 surah or chapters, and they're not compiled in chronological and even sometimes contextual order. So today, Muslims can truthfully read glowing and loving prose about peace and tolerance in the Quran, and how caring and gentle the act of proselytizing should be. Hands down, that should pretty much end the discussion. Or you're a racist or an Islamophobe. Well, not quite. You see, the truth of the matter is that Muhammad and his scribes built in a sort of safety net for when they stated that Allah wanted to head in a different direction. It's called abrogation, and it's a rule in Quran that states that Allah can remove, replace, reinterpret virtually anything previously stated by Allah. For example, in the Quran it reads, "None of our revelations do we abrogate or cause to be forgotten, but we substitute something better or similar. Knowest thou not that Allah has power over all things?" Quran 2:106. In verse 85, 21 and 22, it reads, "Yet it is a glorious Quran on a guarded board." Now, what is being said here? What's happening is that the Quran is written on a board in heaven and it's being guarded from any change. So from such verses, one might think that the words of the Quran are written consistently and without contradiction of any sort or any change. But how many chapters in the Quran contain abrogation? Actually, 71 chapters out of that 114 contain abrogation, which is over 60% of the Quran. Sometimes it's just one verse. For example, verse 9:5, which is called the verse of the sword. This verse abrogates 124 verses that are written in the Quran that speak softly and peacefully about other religions and other people, such as the people of the book, Christians, Jews, and Sabians. One of the most famous abrogations of the Quran is referred to as the Satanic Verses. This is a surah that heralded the intercessory power of Allah's daughters, Alat, Al-Uzza, and Manat. This was consistent with the pagan traditions practiced by Muhammad's tribe at the day. Al-Uzza was even represented by the black stone that Muhammad kissed at the Kaaba. However, these verses were shortly after and later abrogated by Muhammad, who claimed that Satan had fooled him and that the verses were actually not from Allah. Some of you may remember that in the 1990s, a fatwa, or contract to kill, was put out on Salman Rushdie for blaspheming Islam by referencing the satanic verses in one of his novels. You know, there are three different types of abrogation in the Quran. The first type is when the verse is removed totally from the Quran and Muslims are no longer required to practice its teachings. This is found in such verses where Muslims and Muhammad could no longer remember them because Allah caused them to be forgotten. The second type of abrogation is when the verse exists, but it's no longer practiced. These are the verses Muslims use in the West to prove that the Quran is not a hateful or barbaric book. These are the early Makkah or Medina verses. However, according to the Muslim scholars, the later verses, which Muhammad received, supersede the earlier verses. If there's any contradiction, abrogation. A sample of such early tolerant verses can be seen in verse 262, which says, "Surely those who believed, and those who are Jews, and the Nasara, and the Sabian, whoever believe in Allah and the last day, and did a good deed, so they will have their azure with their Lord and no fear on them, and they will not grieve." Now such a verse teaches that Christians and Jews and idol worshippers will have a place in heaven. But this verse was abrogated when Allah later says in the Quran, verse 385, "And whoever desire any other religion except Islam, so it will not be accepted from him, and in the hereafter he will be among the losers." In verse 861, "And if they lean toward peace, so lean toward it." In chapter 225, it states that there's no compulsion in religion. Now, such verses and many other verses will give the reader the impression that the Quran is an inclusive and tolerant book. But the fact that almost all of these verses have been abrogated with Surah 9:5, when Allah reportedly told Muhammad, "So, when the forbidden months are past, so kill the polytheists wherever you find them, and take them as captives, and besiege them, and lay wait for them with every kind of ambush. So, if they repent and become Muslim, and perform prayer, and give the legal alms, so leave their way free. Surely, Allah is forgiving and merciful." Also in verse 9:29, Allah says, "Engage in war with those who do not believe in Allah and the last day, and do not believe in the religion of truth among those who have been given the book, Jews, Christians, and Sabians." Such newer verses abrogate the previous verses, and Muslims are commanded to live by the new verses, not the old verses. So, to be devoted, a Muslim must follow the rules of abrogation. The third type of abrogation is when the written verse is gone completely, but Muslims are still commanded to practice such verses as we see in the practicing of, say, the ordinance of stoning. Stoning of an adulterer, for example. When women commit adultery in Islam, the Sharia law, Islamic law, commands them to be punished by stoning them to death. Now, even though the written verse from the Quran has been totally removed. Taqiya and Kitman. Now, these are specific permissions in the Quran for Muslims to deceive others when it benefits them or progresses the cause of Islam. Now, this even includes the denial of being a Muslim. You know, many other forms of simple dissimulation to mislead one's opponent is also part of taqiya. In Bukhari, it says, "He who makes peace between the people by inventing good information or saying good things is not a liar." Kitman is stating part of a statement, which is truthful, but whose full context would reveal that the initial statement, although true, was a lie in light of the whole truth. An example would be if a Muslim claimed that jihad means an inner struggle for higher spiritual attainment. Although it could mean that to some people, this meaning is actually abrogated by a later revelation which clearly shows jihad is a declaration of violence. Islam history shows a long line of treaties agreed to by Muhammad, only later to be revealed as merely a ruse in order to conquer an enemy. And right on time, Allah provided a ready cover or excuse as to why the treachery of breaking a treaty was a righteous deed. When it came to peace, Muhammad could definitely not be taken at his word. Sharia law. Well, there's been a lot of talk here in the United States about heavily populated Muslim communities looking to adapt or institute Sharia law within their communities. In many other non-Islamic countries like Germany, Denmark, and England, it's already being accomplished. It's a progressive process. It increases as the number of Muslims increase, creating greater influence in the region. For example, today in Europe, Muslims are actually utilizing the principles of Sharia as a legal defense for beating their wives and for polygamy. And polygamous wives of Muslims claiming single indigent status has actually created an unprecedented drain on government entitlement programs in those countries. The term Sharia literally means the path to a watering hole. Sharia is a religious code for living, in the same way that the Bible offers a moral system for Christians. It's used to refer to both the Islamic system of law and the totality of the Islamic way of life. Sharia is derived both from the teachings of the Quran and from the Sunnah. Punishments described in Islam, like caning or whipping, the cutting off of hands and or feet, beheading, and stoning to death, are regularly instituted across the Islamic world. And Sharia's intolerance towards homosexuals and intolerance towards groups like women, well, I should place it under the highest scrutiny of all progressives and liberals who cry out constantly for social justice. And yet, it goes on day in and day out, almost totally unnoticed and regularly unreported. So what kind of lifestyle does Sharia create? Well, how about for poverty? Sharia societies are very poor on the whole, and as a consequence of their ideology, the total GDP of the Arab world, minus the oil revenues, is actually less than that of the tiny country of Finland. How about unemployment? Sharia societies experience mass unemployment. Iran's youth unemployment, for example, is 34% or more. Saudi Arabia, 25%. The Palestinians have unemployment of between 25 and 40%. Israel's is around 9%. In France and England, Muslim unemployment is 3 times the national average. How about technology and innovation? Sharia societies have a dreadful track record on innovation. More patents were issued last year to the people of Utah than have ever been issued in the entire history of all Sharia societies combined. You know, we recall Bernard Lewis's oft-repeated comment that Islamic languages don't have a good equivalent for the word curiosity. How about freedom of speech? Well, there's very little freedom of speech in Sharia countries, as the cartoon riots all over the Islamic Sharia world amply demonstrates. Freedom of speech only exists where freedom of controversial speech is tolerated and protected. How about freedom of the press? Well, freedom of the press doesn't exist in Sharia countries, where journalists are jailed or killed for failing to toe the party line. Censorship in Islamic world is instilled at childhood. How about freedom of religion? Sharia societies frown on and prohibit the free exercise of religion. Sharia societies like Saudi Arabia don't even permit churches or synagogues on their soil. Moreover, Sharia societies put apostates to death or exact other punishments for ceasing to believe in Islam. About women's rights? Sharia societies are famous for their lack of women's rights. In strict Sharia societies, women can't even drive cars, or vote, or walk the streets unaccompanied. A woman's testimony counts only half of that of a man's testimony in the Sharia courts. How about homosexual rights? Well, they hang homosexuals in Iran, and there appears to be a universal agreement in Sharia societies that homosexuality must be punished. Mental health treatment. In Sharia societies, man was created with a fitrah, an inherent nature that's pure and sinless. The Freudian concept of the unconscious is totally rejected. Instead, being crazy in the Islamic perspective means that one is possessed by the jinn or demons. And by the way, jinn is a term that we use from genies, like in the Arab times. Educating the young. Well, in Sharia societies, we have textbooks that say Jews are apes and pigs. They say that jihad is a summit of Islam, and that a Muslim cannot maintain a loyal friendship with a non-Muslim. Sharia societies have TV shows and videos of children pledging suicide murder to kill Jews. Now, normally, we'd call this section evangelizing or proselytizing. Maybe we'd refer to those Muslims spreading their religion of peace as missionaries. Well, isn't that how we here in the West would refer to other religions like the Lutherans or Baptists, Mormons, Pentecostals? Unfortunately, that's not always the way religions work. In fact, aggressive, imperialistic efforts like one theocratic people conquering another people marks the growth of many religions throughout the centuries. By the way, that includes the Judeo-Christian heritage. Did you know that the Bible numbers 2,476,633 people that were killed based on Judeo-Christian beliefs? Think about it. From King David to Joshua and Saul, we're talking about hundreds of battles, some of which they believed included God telling them to annihilate every living thing in the city. Over 2 million people, that's a lot. Even spread over 2,000 or 3,000 years, that's a lot of blood being spilled for the sake of religion. Now, Islam began in the historical shadow of exactly this kind of Old Testament battle and war heritage. So it's perhaps not that shocking to understand how these historical acts could be viewed or rationalized an instituted practice that would be used by Islam. However, let's see if maybe we can add a little perspective. If you take all of the deaths from wars waged in the name of the Judeo-Christian tradition, even after the New Testament was written, you've got to include another couple of thousand years. See, that would add in the Crusades, the Spanish Inquisition, the witch trials, and a bunch of other horrific events. Now, although it may be true that the Crusades were predominantly a response to prior Islamic invasions, and many so-called Christian battles were merely a disguise or precept for the actual political power play of the leaders that day, who may have cloaked themselves in religion, if you take the time to count all of these events, add them all together, right up to the present day, including all of the deaths attributed to the Jews in pursuit of reestablishing Israel during the 20th century, you'll end up with somewhere between 4 and 5 million deaths. I know that's a lot. But Islam, on the other hand, surpassed this 4,000-year Judeo-Christian death total within its first decade. To help give some more perspective, here's a graph that may better depict the not-so-fine missionary work of the jihadist Muslim community. If you take all of the 10 most despicable mass-murdering maniacs from the past couple hundred years, which includes this famous quartet, Adolf Hitler, Mao Zedong, Joseph Stalin, and Pol Pot, and you added all of their genocides and mass slaughters together, you know, you still wouldn't even come close to the numbers racked up by Islam. Someone once said that more people have been killed in the name of religion than for any other cause. And unfortunately, if you look at the total deaths by war, you can begin to see why. As we've seen, the early conquests of Islam had more to do with control and conquest than it did conversion. The engine that spread Islam was fueled by plunder and sexual exploitation by these nomadic jihadist warriors. Conversion required an effort and knowledge and understanding of the Islamic faith, which left out almost everybody but Muhammad and a few followers who'd memorized the Quran. Once a people group is plundered, with the wealth and beauty ravaged, they become a rather unattractive target. So, with every conquest grows a list of potential rebels fraught with revenge. No empire could exist fueled by conquest alone. So, the spread of Islam saw modifications to the Quran that accommodated some changes, which included the establishment, the rule of law, and social and religious indoctrination for a conquered people and their land, all in an effort to maintain social control. To do this, Islam applied a tax known as the jizya. Muslims would then settle in their new kingdoms with their slaves, harems, and loot, and begin a long process of subjugation under what would later become Sharia law, which placed all non-Muslims in a subservient role. They were not quite slaves, but definitely not free. Muslim warriors were carefully kept away from the settled areas to avoid intermarriage, which meant conversion, and from the status of a dhimmi to the loss of jizya. So that conversion wasn't always high on the list during the early growth of Islam. Also, with the advent of jihad raids, many Muslims acquired substantial numbers of slaves and concubines, and conversion of those slaves or concubines to Islam also created a loss, which was regularly avoided. So clearly, conversion to Islam was not the highest priority of jihad. It may have been the unfair treatment of those who were allowed to live that made conversion to Islam most attractive. Some of that subjugation was the jizya tax, but depending on who from the Islamic horde took over control of which city, the religious pressure could be more or less. This second form of spreading the gospel of Islam eventually found its way into the Quran, as exampled by this particular passage. So when the sacred months have passed, then slay the idolaters, wherever you find them, and take them captives, and besiege them, and lie in wait for them in every ambush. Then, if they repent, and keep up prayer, and pay the poor rate, leave their way free to them. Surely Allah is forgiving and merciful. Again it says, fight those who do not believe in Allah, nor in the latter day, nor do they prohibit what Allah and His Apostle have prohibited, nor follow the religion of truth out of those who have been given the book, until they pay the tax in acknowledgement of superiority, and they are in a state of subjection. Next up, we'll look at Islam's influence, including demographics, jihad, subjugation, and Islam's influence in U.S. politics. Let's take a look at some demographics. Let's assume that there are about 1.7 million Muslims. But they're not all here in the USA. In fact, still a very small minority number, well under 10 million. Until 20 years ago, the Jewish population actually outnumbered the Muslim population. On the world stage, Islam and Christianity are almost on par with one another. Judaism doesn't even register. Buddhism, Hinduism, and other Chinese folk religions account for a similar amount. So, where do Muslims live? As you can see, the answer is pretty much everywhere. This map is shaded so that darker areas represent more Muslims living in the region. The darkest color here represents 200 million Muslim residents. Now, this map shows you the population density rather than numbers. As you can see, the Middle East and Northern Africa have the most densely concentrated populations of Muslims. Still far greater than Europe, but European growth through larger family sizes, but especially through immigration, is quickly changing that. As you can see here, in the US, 63% of American Muslims are first-generation immigrants, and 45% of all resident Muslims arrived here after 1990. Muslims acquire citizenship at a much higher ratio than general immigrant population. Muslims in general are more than twice as likely to say they are satisfied with the way the US is operating. This you may find quite shocking. Pew Research also found that 5% of Muslims in the USA espouse their support for Al-Qaeda. 8% believe that suicide bombings of innocent women and children is justified. And nearly a quarter of them believe that there is significant support for Islamic extremists. Finally, nearly half of all Muslim Americans say that Muslims themselves have not done enough to stem the growth and influence of Islamic extremism. A lot's been said about jihad lately, over the past two decades. It's a word that entered our vocabulary with a distinctly negative connotation, despite the fact that millions of practicing Muslims believe that it merely refers to a personal struggle in following Allah. Jihad is translated to mean a struggle. Our introduction to jihad 20 years ago framed it as a declaration of holy war against Israel and the West in general. But was that fair? The information in this presentation will allow you to leave with a factual understanding of what jihad really is. You're going to be able to dispel the innuendo and allegations of ignorance, phobia, or racism that are commonly applied to someone who accurately assesses and then confidently asserts to understand the true meaning and implications of jihad. In the tradition of Islam, Muslims refer to it as the religion of peace. Keep in mind that no matter how many Muslims believe in peace and may even believe that jihad is only a spiritual struggle, it does not and it cannot change or in any way mitigate the meaning that Islam has clearly established for this word. Is jihad an obligation of every Muslim? is at core to the ideology and the practice of Islam? Well, the best way to find out is to see what Islam says is the core and foundation of its belief system. So to do that, we would start with the Shahada, the profession of faith for Muslims. There is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his messenger. So important and so core to Islam is the Shahada that the mere profession of it can instantly convert any person of any station in life from a lowly infidel to a Muslim. However, Shahada also means martyrdom. In the noun form Shahid, that means martyr. The Islamic creed can be found most often printed on either a headband or arm banners, and it's the common garb worn by jihadists and suicide bombers in more than 60 different countries. The creed of the best-known Muslim organization, the Muslim Brotherhood, is as follows. Allah is our objective. The Quran is our law. The Prophet is our leader. Jihad is our way. And death, for the sake of Allah, is the highest of our aspirations. So, what else is core to Islam? Well, let's see, that would be Muhammad, right? We've already learned quite a bit about his actions, but what did Muhammad have to say when it came to fighting and terror? In his own words. And of course, as we all remember, float like a butterfly and sting like a bee. Well, that's probably the wrong Muhammad, but let's go with what Ibn Habib narrates about the Messenger Allah. He stated that the best jihad is the one in which your horse is slain and your blood is spilled. In a similarly worded hadith, Nuhas cited a hadith for Musnad Ahmad ibn Hanbal, where it states that the highest kind of jihad is the person who is killed whilst spilling the last of his blood. So, what else is core and foundational to Islam? That would be the Quran, right? Keep in mind, although verses were reportedly recited and memorized during the first days of Muhammad's reign, the first actual written version didn't occur until well after Muhammad's death. The Quran orders all Muslims to fight those who don't believe in Muhammad's claims. The Quran incites Muslims to fight unbelievers or infidels. I know that sounds harsh, but clearly it's communicated in the Quran. In Surah 8:39, the Quran says, "Fight them on, until there is no seduction, until this religion is the only religion of Allah." Another verse, Surah 9:12, says, "Fight the chiefs of infidelity, that they may be exterminated." And in Surah 9:36, we read that Muslims are to fight the infidel all. "When your Lord revealed to the angels, I am with you. Therefore, make firm those who believe. I will cast terror into the hearts of those who disbelieve. Therefore, strike off their heads and strike off every fingertip of them." It's clear from the study of these and many other verses of the Quran that the requirement of the Quran is to subjugate all non-Muslims if they don't accept Islam. Now, Allah willingly wants them to be exterminated because the goal of jihad or holy war is to make the whole world embrace one socio-political religious ideology. Islam. Okay, just to make sure you don't think that this is all ancient history and that I'm picking on old traditions that today smarter, more peaceful Muslims would never follow, I present the following. This is part of the first page of an ongoing record of Islamic terrorist attacks through the jihad. Since 9/11, there have been just shy of 18,000 separate recorded incidents. As you can see here, sometimes that means multiple deaths and injuries per event. I'd like to show you more, but believe it or not, just the list for October of 2011 alone covered 9 pages. So, with all of this proof of an ideology based on violence, literally taken directly out of the Islamic scriptures, the life of the Prophet, and a millennium of historical documentation, you might ask yourself, why doesn't everyone in America already know this. We'll talk about that more in detail when we talk about Islam and its influence on U.S. politics. But up next, we're going to learn about two other methods of subjugation other than creating a dhimmi society. These are two forms of Islam you probably knew nothing about. They're slavery and pirating. Keep in mind that Islam means to submit, and these forms of ultimate submissions have been dominated by Islam since its introduction in the 7th century.
I must admit that I too, among hundreds of millions of educated people, was under the impression that the African slave trade was the sole responsibility of the Christian Europeans, the white race. That is, until I started exploring the subject in greater depth, and especially after reading an incredibly enlightening book called The Legacy of Arab Islam in Africa by John Alambila Azuma. My whole perspective and understanding has changed dramatically, and I would like you to tell us more about this subject.
The success of Muhammadan Islam in deceiving, misinforming, deforming, and contorting both history and reality over a period of almost 1400 years has been astounding. That is, until now. The greatest tragedy about this particular subject is that most of the descendants of African slavery, the black people in the Americas, around the world, as well as among the African blacks, are totally ignorant of the actual facts. Before we lose the concentration of our listeners, I would like to make the following statement and then prove it. That the worst, most inhumane, and most diabolical institution of the black African slave trade was initiated, refined, perpetrated, and implemented by the Muhammadan Arabs and later aided and abetted by the black converts to Muhammadan Islam. I predict that, as usual, the two subcultures, those of denial of facts and of political correctness, will attack us without once disproving a single statement and or conclusion that we make. Slavery was not created by the white races, because it has existed throughout human history and practiced by every tribe, culture, civilization, racial group, and religion. In fact, the very word slavery has its root in the name Slav, based upon the Slavic peoples of Europe who were subjugated by other Europeans. It is not common knowledge that the Arabic word abd is synonymous with the meaning of slave. For example, Abdullah means literally the slave of Allah, and that in the language of the Arabs, all black peoples are called abid, plural, for slaves. While much has been written concerning the transatlantic slave trade, surprisingly little attention has been paid to the Islamic slave trade across the Sahara, the Red Sea, and the Indian Ocean. While the European involvement in the African transatlantic slave trade to the Americas lasted for just over 3 centuries, the Arab involvement in the African slave trade has lasted 14 centuries, and in some parts of the Muhammadan world is still continuing to this day. The birth of Muhammadan Islam and its conquests brought about the birth of institutionalized, systematized, and religiously sanctioned slave trade on a massive and global scale. In fact, the Quran allows the taking of slaves as booty or reward for wars of aggression against any and all unbelievers, most of the human population. This has led to an enormous number of so-called holy wars, jihad in Arabic. There was and is absolutely nothing holy about these wars, which are primarily to plunder, slaughter, rape, subjugate, and rob other human beings of their wealth, produce, freedom, and dignity. Muhammadan Muslim states and tribes attacked other non-Muslim groups to achieve these objectives. Although Islamic jurisprudence laid down regulations for the treatment of slaves, however, incredible and heinous abuses have occurred throughout the history of Muhammadan Islam. By the Middle Ages, the Arabic word abid was in general used to denote a black slave, while the word mamluk referred to a white slave. Ibn Khaldun, 1332 to 1406, the preeminent Islamic medieval historian and social thinker, wrote, "The Negro nations are, as a rule, submissive to slavery, because they have attributes that are quite similar to dumb animals." It should also be noted that black slaves were castrated based on the assumption that the blacks had an ungovernable sexual appetite. When the Fatimid Caliphate came to power in Egypt, they slaughtered all the tens of thousands of black military slaves and raised an entirely new slave army. Some of these slaves were conscripted into the army at age 10. From Persia to Egypt to Morocco, slave armies from 30,000 to up to 250,000 became commonplace. The Islamic slave trade took place across the Sahara Desert, from the coast of the Red Sea, and from East Africa across the Indian Ocean. The Trans-Sahara trade was conducted along six major slave routes. Just in the 19th century, for which we have more accurate records, 1.2 million slaves were brought across the Sahara into the Middle East, as well as a further 450,000 down the Red Sea and 442,000 from the East African coastal ports. That is a total of 2 million black slaves just in the 1800s. At least 8 million more were calculated to have died before reaching the Muslim slave markets. A comparison of the Islamic slave trade to the American slave trade reveals some extremely interesting contrasts. While 2 out of every 3 slaves shipped across the Atlantic were men, the proportions were reversed in the Islamic slave trade. 2 women for every man were enslaved by the Muslims. While the mortality rate of slaves being transported across the Atlantic was as high as 10%, the percentage of slaves dying in transit in the Trans-Sahara and East African slave market was a staggering 80 to 90%. While almost all the slaves shipped across the Atlantic were for agricultural work, most of the slaves destined for the Muslim Middle East were for sexual exploitation as concubines, in harems, and for military service. While many children were born to the slaves in the Americas, the millions of their descendants are citizens in Brazil and the United States of today. Very few descendants of the slaves that ended up in the Middle East survive. While most slaves who went to the Americas could marry and have families, most of the male slaves destined for the Middle East were castrated, and most of the children born to the women were killed at birth. It is estimated that possibly as many as 11 million Africans were transported across the Atlantic, 95% of which went to South and Central America, mainly to Portuguese, Spanish, and French possessions. Only 5% of the slaves ended up in what we call the United States today. However, a minimum of 28 million Africans were enslaved in the Muslim Middle East. Since at least 80% of those captured by Muslim slave traders were calculated to have died before reaching the slave markets, it is believed that the death toll from 1400 years of Arab and Muslim slave raids into Africa could have been as high as 112 million. When added to the number of those sold in the slave markets, the total number of African victims of the Trans-Saharan and East African slave trade could be significantly higher than 140 million people. What is obscene about this whole subject is the Mohammedan Muslim and Arab culture of denial regarding their complicity in the African slave trade, as well as the ignorance of black Muslims about the reality of their past and present conditions. The statistics and reports above are based upon the logbooks kept at the African slave ports, ship logs, travelers' reports, eyewitness accounts, etc. Ladies and gentlemen, the facts and reality of Mohammedan Islam's complicity in the slave trade and their inhuman depravity are infinitely more devastating, more staggering, and more incomprehensible than all the nightmare fictions in the world.
Now, let's take a look at another form of Islamic subjugation. It's called pirating. No, not all pirates are Muslims. However, factual history shows us that pirating was completely fueled by and dominated by Islam. Wrapped in cries of jihad, like the early days of Muhammad, jihads and pirating were fueled by money, power, and sexual gratification as their primary motivators. Again, it's important to separate in your mind the difference between Muslims and Islam. Muslims can be good-hearted, loving neighbors who only believe the very best and most peaceful and loving traditions in their scriptures, and are either completely unaware of or choose to ignore the historical and factual realities that we've shared during this presentation. Plundering on sea is not far removed from plundering on land, especially trade ships or rich port cities filled with merchants and goods. The significant astronomy skills cultivated by some Middle Eastern peoples living on water routes quickly created a dominating Islamic presence on the open seas. History tells us that within several hundred years, the maritime raids orchestrated by Islam's leaders had left the major port cities throughout the Mediterranean and even along the European coast, as far north as Iceland, virtually uninhabitable, as Islamic pirates sought Christian slaves for their lucrative Middle Eastern trade market. Now, we're not talking thousands, we're talking literally millions of non-Muslim white slaves. Muslims were prominent in shipbuilding and shipping and the shipping industries all throughout the time. A fledgling United States of America had its first encounter with Islam shortly after the Revolutionary War, when the dominant force of the British Admiralty discontinued protecting colonial merchant ships. Islamic pirates from the Barbary coast of North Africa captured, enslaved, and ransomed many thousands of U.S. citizens. Thomas Jefferson, Benjamin Franklin, and John Adams were sent to Europe specifically to negotiate with the Muslims. For 15 years, earnestly attempting to understand their position, until finally, Jefferson received the following explanation. Ambassador Sid Haji Abdul Rahman Aja had answered that Islam was founded on the laws of their prophet, that it was written in their Quran that all nations who should not have acknowledged their authority were sinners, that it was their right and duty to make war upon them wherever they could be found, and to make slaves of all they could take as prisoners, and that every Muslim who should be slain in battle was sure to go to paradise. Well, the U.S. government in 1800 paid 20% of its total annual revenue as a tribute, plus some additional ransom costs, to these Islamic pirates. Tribute is another word for extortion money, by the way. That finally ended when Jefferson took office, stating, "We will spend millions for defense, but not 1 cent more for tribute." Did you know our first war was against Islam? Our founding fathers, with direct, face-to-face meetings over nearly two decades, some of the most brilliant and honorable men of the time, came to the conclusion that this was a case of an Islamic holy war against a Christian nation, and no rational course could dissuade it. For 4 years, we battled in an attempt to rescue American slaves and ensure safe passage for future trade, and America's first war was against Islam. And it was our brave Marines risking their lives at the Battle of Dern on the African coast that gave us those immortal words, "To the shores of Tripoli." Like many other treaties with Islam, the treaty was broken less than a decade later, and we were forced to return and finish a job costing even more money and more precious American lives. Today, this is the face of Islam still in the pirating business, capturing, killing, taking slaves, and ransoming. Not much has changed. Unlike some progressives, most of us believe we can't change history. So for us, one of the most important questions should be, why is it that so few people know about this? According to GuideStar charity reports, there are more than 250 Islamic nonprofits here in North America. Out of the Department of State, 58 designated foreign terrorist organizations exist, and 46 are Islamic organizations. The IIRO, International Islamic Relief Organization, along with 15 other organizations, were named in legal documents as providing aid to terrorist groups. Some of these groups funded terrorist training camps and sent weapons to Afghanistan. Many of them actually have the terrorists on their payroll in order to provide ongoing funding. the number of mosques has grown by more than 20% in the past 10 years, while the growth rate for Christian churches and synagogues is less than 3%. The growth rate for Muslims here in the U.S. is 5 times greater than the average growth rate, being slightly below 1%. So we have a large number of left-leaning, big government immigrants. And this matters because Muslims acquire citizenship at a rate nearly twice the average of other immigrants. Arguably, their best-known organization, CARE, the Council on American-Islamic Relations, an organization named as a co-conspirator in a terrorist funding trial, had set the goal of generating 100,000 additional voters over the next 8 months. They're actively involved. In Germany, which has a Muslim population ratio similar to that of America, Muslims are 4 times more likely to be receiving government benefits. In Denmark, Muslims make up 5% of the population but account for nearly 40% of the welfare spending. Polygamy creates a unique factor there, and it contributes to these unusually high levels of social dependency where multiple wives claim single status to receive benefits. Are Muslims good citizens? Well, my answer should not surprise you. It's absolutely and wholeheartedly yes. Muslims can be fantastic citizens and even better neighbors. I can say that with confidence because I understand, as you should, that each and every Muslim is an individual. However, a Muslim who carefully and devotedly follows the core foundations of Islam incrementally contributes to the single greatest threat to freedom and peace on the face of the earth today. In addition to national lobbying groups, who are exceptionally successful in gaining the ear of high-ranking congressional and White House officials, there's a UN lobby. The Alliance of Civilizations is a UN lobby organization started in 2006 with the publicized goal of bridging the gaps between Muslim and Western civilizations. Now, President Obama announced his decision to join this organization, whose working premise is this: relations with the West are difficult because of the existence of Israel and the appearance that the West is sympathetic towards Israel. So that's the only problem. Obama's public outreach to Islam has been unprecedented, including placing the highest priority for NASA to be the outreach to the Islamic world. His bow to the Saudi king raised some eyebrows, as did his first call as a newly elected president, which was to Mahmoud Abbas, the president of the Palestinians, who is a racist, a Holocaust denier, and a person who played a primary role in the founding and operations of the terrorist activity of the PLO. His private one-on-one meeting with Hassan Kazini, an Iranian political agent, as well as supporter and fundraiser for Hamas and Hezbollah, was perhaps even more disturbing. But that's all just politics, right? I don't plan on getting into Obama's childhood exposure to Islam through prayers, mosques, Quranic studies, or his family and relationships. Sufficient to say that if a brief affiliation with, say, Wicca becomes a national disqualifier for a congressional candidate, how is it that the verifiable historical facts and simple truths of Islam could escape this man? 2 weeks after declaring his candidacy, Barack Hussein Obama told the New York Times that the Muslim call to prayer is one of the prettiest sounds on earth at sunset. In an interview with Nicholas Kristof, published in the New York Times, Obama then recited the Muslim call to prayer, the Adhan, with a first-class Arabic accent. The opening lines of the Azan is the Shahada. Allah is supreme. Allah is supreme. I witness that there is no God but Allah. I witness that Muhammad is his prophet. Finally, and quite fitting, we will end where we all begin again: prophecy. As we mentioned before, nearly 24% of the Bible contains predictive material, from Old Testament prophets like Jeremiah, Daniel, and Elijah, to New Testament prophets like Matthew and John of Patmos. Unusual allegory and symbolic language have been used to create a record of what's to come. In Hebrew tradition, there are 3 types of prophecy: prophetic utterance, symbolic visions, and prophetic type. An example of a prophetic type is Abraham's sacrifice of his son Isaac on Mount Moriah, which was a type of another father's true sacrifice of his only son, Jesus, which occurred on that same mountain nearly 2 millennia later. There are two main focuses of prophecy in the Bible. One is messianic, which is having to do with Messiah, Jesus, in the Christian tradition, and end times or apocalyptic prophecy. We're going to focus on that latter of these two, the end times. But calling it the end times really doesn't do it justice, because for Christians, it's really the beginning of new times. You see, the short version, well, it's that Jesus is going to return, he's going to clean up Dodge City, and he and his chosen are going to live happily ever after. In essence, it's a story of a new beginning. Believe me, there are a lot more details than that, I know. And for many, it becomes very confusing, even to the learned and the wise. So we're going to keep it a little simpler. And I'm going to describe it in a way I believe God might describe it to his own child. So who are the main characters and what are the main events of the end times according to the Bible? First, there are the bad guys. Because I hope I'm not the first to break it to you, but in the Bible, things on earth get much worse before they get better. All right, brace yourselves. In the Bible, there is a character referred to as the first beast. Well, not that one. Yeah, okay, yeah, much better. This first beast comes out and is coming out of the water, which represents nations or people. The various attributes of this beast are described in detail, which also reveals what much of the symbolism represents. This first beast, its power comes from the serpent or Satan. It's referred to as the Antichrist or against or opposite of Christ. According to the Bible, we can expect this beast to set up a one-world government and economy, establish one worldwide religion, create a new time standard, and change the laws. Well, that sounds like he's a pretty productive fellow. He's got to be pretty talented to accomplish all of that. So why is he the bad guy? Why do they call him the beast? And why does he look so scary? Okay, let's go to the beast number two. Now you think that one's scary. Wait till you see the second beast, which is even more ferocious. The Bible simply says that this beast has two horns and looks like a lamb. But it speaks as a dragon. Pretty terrifying, huh? This beast helps the first beast and is his very prominent religious assistant. It's referred to as the false prophet, helping to convert everyone on earth to the religion that worships the first beast. This second beast will help convert people to the religion or help behead those that refuse. Then there's a beast with a harlot, or better translated as idolatrous, on its back. This time, more of the scary details are included. You see, the harlot is for a time directing the beast, and her adulteries, or idolatries, led many astray, and she had much blood of the saints on her hands. The beast eventually overcomes and kills the harlot to take total control alone. Next, gladly we find some good guys, the witnesses. They have a rather unenviable job, though. They preach and prophesy in the Middle East and elsewhere for 3.5 years, after the first beast has sacked Israel and is in the midst of establishing the new ruling order. They've been given great powers to perform miracles and to defend themselves and even disrupt nature, including casting plagues. They raise havoc with this new regime as the witnesses attempt to warn others by exposing the beast's ultimate plans. Eventually, the witnesses are cruelly martyred in Jerusalem by the second beast, about 3.5 years in. Finally, we get to the good guys and the rescue as Jesus returns. So, we've got a pretty simple recap: a saving Messiah, the world in calamity, and then all of a sudden, judgment. Evil is punished, good is rewarded, the resurrection, and then life everlasting with God in heaven. Okay, now, how about the end times for Islam? That can be understood through the Quran and the Hadith. Islam demands that all Muslims believe and facilitate the end time descriptions. The first character is the Al-Mahdi, or the 12th Imam. Al-Mahdi was the son of the 11th Imam, or Caliphate ruler, in the 9th century, a direct descendant of Muhammad. He would have been the 12th Imam, however, at the age of 5, as he was about to take over the tribal prayer for his father's funeral service, he was said to have been spirited away. Shia Twelvers, tens of millions of highly devoted Muslims, believe he has been occultated deep in the earth and will return in the last days of judgment. Al-Mahdi's description, according to Islam, he arrives on the scene after a period of great turmoil. He'll make a 7-year peace treaty with Israel. He'll conquer Israel. He'll have his headquarters in Jerusalem and become the universal leader of all Muslims. He'll establish a new world order or government, redistribute wealth to the populace, and cause only Islam to be the practiced religion. He'll wage war against Jews and Christians, and he'll end up beheading all non-believers. Next is Isha, or Isa. This is the Islamic name for Jesus. Although Islam doesn't believe Jesus is the Son of God, or that he was crucified and resurrected, they do believe that he is coming back to help the Al-Mahdi convert the entire world to a single religion, Islam. He'll help the Mahdi capture and kill all of the Jews and Christians that won't convert to Islam. So Isa, his future accomplishments include, according to Islam, he will be subordinate to the Mahdi, directs all of the attention off himself and onto the Mahdi. He'll be a devout Muslim. He'll institute Islamic Sharia law. He'll act as a Muslim evangelist, abolishing Christianity, kill the Dajjal, which we'll talk about in a moment, as well as his Jewish followers, and persecute Christians and Jews and forces them to convert or face beheading. He will remain on earth for about 4 years, and he marries and eventually dies. That's Isha. Next is the beast that Islam will send out from within the earth. Dabat ul-Ard. Now this beast has 4 feet like the feet of a camel and wings like a bird. Its head is like the head of an ox. Its ears are like the ears of an elephant. Its tail is like the tail of a ram. Now this beast will be released because people would not believe in Islam, at least according to Islam. One of his duties will be stamping the face of Muslims so that they can be recognized as the believers, and also marking the face of unbelievers so that they will be found out. The beast will come up to him and stamp his face, saying, "Thus, believers will be distinguished from disbelievers, and they will be recognized," according to the Quran. Now, the Quran tells us about the beasts of the earth, and when the word is fulfilled against them, the unjust, we shall produce from the earth a beast to face them. He will speak to them, for that mankind did not believe with assurance in our signs. Quran 27:82. Then there is the Dajjal. This means dark messiah. He's of Jewish descent and will appear in Judea, claiming to represent Jesus, the Christian messiah. Blind in his right eye, he will attempt to gather the Israelites together. Muslims are told definitely to avoid him, and they will know him because Kaf, Fa, and Ra will be visible on his forehead, which means disbelief, meaning disbelief in Islam. He will be able to perform miraculous deeds, including controlling the weather and causing plagues. Now, we're going to compare the two side by side, or rather top to bottom, using their own scriptures and teachings. The current era we are in today is referred to by Christians as the era of grace. Islam refers to this era as the reign of tyrannical rule. Now, knowingly or unknowingly, these two groups are almost mere images of each other. As you're about to see, this simple examination of end times eschatology doesn't just show parallels in events, it actually documents what we can call anti-parallels. A rescuer, a redeemer, a ruler, both the Bible and the Quran clearly depict a character that they deem their hero. And in the Bible, it's Jesus. In the Quran, it's the Mahdi. Now, what you may not have realized is that they have some things in common. They both have a supernatural arrival back to Earth and come to conquer an enemy. Each is involved with a devastating worldwide battle to save a group they refer to as believers. And both heroes expect the result of their conquest to be worldwide peace. Finally, both heroes claim to be the one true God. So far, they seem to have everything in common. Next, each scripture describes a military and political takeover of the world. This entails establishing a new system of laws, reorienting the world to a new time standard, and converting the world to a common economy. The Bible says that these things will be accomplished under great duress and with the use of force, in what the Bible calls a time of tribulation. The Quran totally agrees and states that these devastating tactics are necessary to right the wrongs of the world and bring the world to a better spiritual place. So then, both books describe a religious takeover of the world through a character that is a helper to the primary hero in the Quran and a helper to the primary villain in the Bible. The Bible calls him the false prophet, who appears as a lamb but speaks as a dragon. The Quran says it's Isha, Jesus in human form, returned to the earth. So the Bible warns of a false prophet coming in the form of a lamb, and the Quran predicts that a Jew hating Jesus, who despises Christians, will return to help rid the world of Jews and Christians. This character in each eschatology demands conversion to one religion. He performs miracles that convince many he is godlike. He kills Jews en masse and makes sure all non-believers are beheaded. Okay, moving right along. Both the Bible and Quran predict that there will be a 7-year treaty with Israel, and that the treaty will be broken about halfway through, that Jerusalem will be conquered, and 2/3 of the Jews will die in a multinational attack on Israel. In the Bible, this